All right, Miss Wolf, I've looked over your tests, and I have some very bad news.
What is it, Doctor?
Anderson Cooper is buying the house next to mine.
No, I mean about my tests.
Well, you'll never play trampoline dodgeball again.
What? I was at the top of my game. I was dominating that sport. Just patch me up and get me back out there, Doc.
Patch you up? Look at you. Your arm is hanging from your shoulder by those stringy things.
You mean tendons?
I'm not 100% sure. They might be sinews. Or what's the other one? Ligatures?
Ligaments. Are you sure you're a real doctor?
No. Are you a real patient? I'm kidding. Of course I have my MD from the University of...
I'm sorry, from where?
That's the name of it. The University of... You should hear our fight song.
Is there anybody else here that I can see?
You just need to find a new sport. Your arm is shot, and look at that stuff oozing out of your middle leg place.
My knee.
Is that the technical term? You should take up Thorball.
What's that?
You hit a bell with a hammer.
That's the whole game?
Believe me, with your problems, it's the decathlon.
There must be other new sports I can take up, so let's listen to a show about that. And now, the father of Nerf chicken fighting, Colin McEnroe.
Before you leave, I want you to look at this X-ray.
Okay.
If you had to guess, would you say that one's the liver?
God help us.
That sounds like a terrible doctor. Hope he's not the company doctor. All right, so we are talking today about kind of, well, some new sports and some very, very ancient sports, physical activities, kind of difficult to say. But a lot of this, although towards the end of the show, one of the things that we're going to be talking about is the fact that some sports are just – people make up sports all the time. In fact, that's how pickleball, the first sport that that we're going to talk about, came into existence. People, you know, people back in 1965 on Bainbridge Island decided to make up their own little game, and it actually did sort of hang on, and it's gotten really big. But then there are other sports that people make up, and only just a few people ever play them. But they are out there, and thanks to YouTube, you can watch people playing most of them. So in our final segment, you will hear about some of the weirdest sports, most of them played by highly inebriated people that you have ever – I mean more than you've ever dreamed of. It just – I don't know. I can't even characterize it. I can't even talk about it right now. So – but part of the other theme is I think for a lot of us – and I'm in this category. I'm going to be turning 60 later this year. I played basketball and soccer well into my 30s and maybe in one of those sports early 40s. But my knees are shot right now, and I've got a partial tear of my rotator cuff, and you know certain things are a little bit more difficult for me to do. And so I, you know, I found other things to do. I do a lot of, you know, I've done a lot of bicycling, as most people know, over the last few years. But I'm keeping my eye out. Like, what are my other sports? What are some sports that I can do that would be good for me, and would fit maybe a little bit more into my capacities, which are going to narrow a little bit. I mean, in between here and 85, you know, there's going to be some things that are progressively more difficult to do. But I want to have fun, and I want to play games, and I want to be active. Well, you're going to hear in just a second about Tai Chi, which kind of fits into that. You may have seen the piece in Slate saying Tai Chi is the new yoga. Of course, the Tai Chi isn't the new anything. Tai Chi has been around a really long time. But before we do that, let's talk about the aforementioned pickleball. The New York Times seems to feel it necessary to run a new story about the surging qualities of pickleball. About once a month, there's a story in the New York Times about pickleball, as if it's the first time they've ever printed anything about it. So joining us right now is Joe Valenti of Rochester, New York. He is a nationally ranked pickleball player and president of the Valenti Sports Pickleball Club, which has over 660 players. He's hosting the National Indoor Pickleball Tournament on August 1st to the 3rd. It's incredibly enjoyable just to say pickleball. But Joe Valenti, there may be people listening right now thinking, saying, what? Pickle what? What is that? So, you know, in a nutshell or a thumbnail or whatever medium you choose, tell people what pickleball is.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I felt the same way about 3 years ago for the first time when I heard what pickleball was. Once you get over the funny name, it's a combination of tennis, ping pong, and even badminton. It's also called a mini tennis game. So basically you're on a badminton-sized court. You're using a paddle that's a little bit bigger than a ping pong paddle, and you're using a perforated ball, which is like a wiffle ball. And you're hitting a ball over a net like a tennis net. So it's a combination of those three sports. Or, you know, in the Northeast, we play platform tennis. Mm-hmm. So it's very similar to platform tennis, which is the caged-in mini tennis game as well. So that's basically what pickleball is. It's like mini tennis or really big ping pong.
And for some reason, it does seem to – I don't know how – you said maybe about 3 years ago in your case. It does seem to be having, as we keep saying on this show, a moment, right? Suddenly, pickleball is something people are talking about, people are taking up. And I assume part of it is because of this gigantic demographic cohort that's moving into their 60s and maybe moving a little less fluidly.
Yeah, that's exactly it. You've got this huge demographic of – people, you know, in your age group or my parents' age group in their 60s who don't really want to play basketball or soccer anymore, or tennis is getting a little bit tough on the knees and the court's a little bit too big. So they maybe they go to the villages in Florida where, they vacation for a while or out in Arizona during the winter months, and they hear about pickleball and they see it and their friends are doing it, and they get them to get on the court, and it takes about 20 minutes to get acclimated to the sport. I mean, that's it, 20 minutes to go from never playing pickleball to enjoying a sport that you could enjoy for the next 40 years.
So they're doing it, obviously, to keep their bodies moving around, and also there's a lot of fellowship, there's a lot of social enjoyment. There's a bunch of older gentlemen who appear to be in their 70s and 80s near where I live, who do play tennis, you know, in the mornings on the public courts, and I'm very envious of them because they can do that. But you can see that a lot of it is just the fun of getting together, and obviously, you know, any sport you can all enjoy and joke about and tease each other about is a great thing. But it sounds like there's also some other more hyper-competitive pickleball playing. You clearly are not in that age cohort. So what's pickleball to you?
Well, I'm in my 30s. I'm 36, and, you know, I'm tired of playing the men's over 30 or men's over 40 soccer where you never know if you're going to make it to work on time the next morning because you might be in the hospital with a torn ACL or a concussion because the guys you're playing against think it's the World Cup. So I was looking for something a lot more fun, a lot more entertaining, a lot more social, and I have three brothers. We all play. My parents play, so it's a family atmosphere game, and that's how it was designed 50 years ago, you know, out in Seattle, Washington area, the Bainbridge Island. The parents were watching the University of Washington football, and they said, hey, kids, let's go outside. You guys have some fun. We're going to watch the game. And they took a bunch of random parts from badminton and ping pong and drew up a court and said, here, go play. And it's really grown from that, kind of inception of, hey, let's just have fun. Let's go out there and get the hand-eye coordination. It's a real fast-moving sport with your hands, but not necessarily with your legs. So at my level where we play, we can still chase around almost every shot on such a small court, so the points last quite a while, and it's just a lot of fun. That's all I can say. It's addictive, and it's a lot of fun.
We should mention that legend has it anyway that family that started it all had a dog named Pickle, and hence the name. If the ball rolled off the court, the dog would grab the ball, and it was at that point Pickle's ball, right?
Yeah, that's one of the legends of how it got its name. The other legend is they were, you know, right there on the island. A pickle boat is a term used where you take a bunch of oarsmen or crewmen that are remaining, and you put them on their own boat. Mm-hmm. So basically they took all these random parts from a badminton net and a ping pong table and a wiffle ball, these three random things, and put them together, and they called it pickleball. So those are the two legends of pickleball, the name at least.
But it seems to the expansion is phenomenal now, right? I mean, I this thing that started very informally as kind of a family in-joke on an island off the coast of Washington is, I mean, I looked it up today. I live in West Hartford, Connecticut. There's pickleball. I could play pickleball there. I could play pickleball in the next town. And apparently, I could also play it if I were in India, Singapore, New Zealand. Is that right, Joe Valenti? Is it an international sport now?
It is the fastest-growing sport in North America, and it could be the fastest-growing sport in the world. This demographic isn't going away. So you take tennis players in, you know, you got Wimbledon going on right now. You got tennis players in England. They're just feeling, you know, I'm not as fast as I used to be. I want a game that I can, you know, have that feeling of I can get every point. Every point matters, and it's not just a serve and a swing and a miss, and that's it. So, yeah, it's traveling all over the world.
That is, it's amazing, and I really, it can only get bigger because, in fact, I was reading about it. They have divisions. You know, you were talking about playing over 30 or over 40 soccer. I've been there, done that, tore the quadriceps tendon. For pickleball, they have like over 85 divisions, right? I mean, you can play it a really long time.
Yeah, you can play it a really long time. The court is small. It's low impact. It's an underhand serve as opposed to tennis. You get a lot of shoulder injuries in tennis just from that serving motion. So it's an underhand serve, low impact on the body. The camaraderie is there, and the physical activity is there.
Although I did read, I mean, there are players who do an overhead smash. I mean, sure,
you can hit an overhead smash, but the serving motion is underhand. So.
All right, Joe Valeni, it sounds fantastic. We look forward I look forward to pickleball being, in fact, a combination of Tai Chi and pickleball could get me through the next decade or so. So thanks for talking to us today. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we are not only going to talk about Tai Chi, we'll get sort of a small, brief, compressed Tai Chi lesson, and some of WNPR's stalwarts are going to come in here and get that lesson.
Lots of rallies in pickleball. Dink to the left, dink to the right, cobra and a lob, fight, fight, fight. Pickleball is the best around.
All right, we're back. It's time to forget about pickleball, at least momentarily, and to talk about Tai Chi. Robert Qualick is here. Robert Qualick of Litchfield, Connecticut, a longtime practitioner of Yang style Tai Chi. He teaches a weekly class at Sharim Yoga and Fitness Studio in Litchfield. So, Robert Qualick, it's probably harder to answer the question, what is Tai Chi, than it was to answer the question, what is pickleball? Because Tai Chi is a whole bunch of different things. But when you do your thumbnail explanation of it, what do you say?
Well, I say it's a moving meditation, Colin. It is a martial art at its heart and at its root and in its impetus, but it is practiced for its health benefits primarily in America.
And I mean, contained in the word, and I guess the longer term is Tai Chi Chuan, right?
Yes, which means grand ultimate or opposite polarity boxing.
But contained in that name is qi, and I think most of us or many of us do have that notion of qi as being some kind of life energy, right?
So yes, you're correct. Qi is life force or universal energy. However, we have in the West called Tai Chi Chuan Tai Chi because we are attempting to cultivate and manipulate qi. But the word qi is actually different, and because the ch in G in one of the transliteration systems has been pronounced ch as opposed to j as in judge, we have changed the name in the West. Really, it should be called Tai Chi Chuan.
And I want to go back to a couple of verbs you used there in that sentence, cultivate and manipulate. Are we in the West approaching this whole discipline differently than it would be traditionally approached?
Only insofar as we don't practice it as a martial art. Mm-hmm. And you'll see folks in parks early in the morning, some of them in their 60s and 70s, practicing what for them is primarily a physical activity and a meditation, and they may be devoid of knowledge of the martial applications. But in terms of the manipulation of qi, I think that's the same.
How long have you been doing it?
I was introduced to Tai Chi Chuan by John Wei at the New School for Social Research in 1978, so you do the math, 30-some-odd years.
And if you were to describe its impact on your life, what's different about you as a result of having done that? I mean, you've been doing it so long, it may be hard to separate yourself now from the discipline itself. But you know, what would you say?
Well, I have to say I have the benefit of having gone away from it and come back to it. Mm-hmm. So I do have a very clear sense of the impact it has on me. And it helps me stay focused and centered and grounded and relaxed. And when I don't practice, those qualities in my personality tend to go away.
So what we're going to do here is, and you can follow along at home. He'll do his best. Before I even start this off, though, I mean, obviously we're going to do a very short thing where people could just sort of get a general idea. If they were to go to one of your classes, how long a class is that? How much Tai Chi Chuan would we be doing?
All the classes at Shireem last for 75 minutes so that when folks buy a package of 10 or unlimited number of classes, they can use their package for yoga and the Tai Chi class if they want. So it's a 75-minute session, including a warm-up and then practice of what's called the form.
Mm-hmm. Is there anything at the end like the equivalent of Shavasana where you just get to lie on the floor?
There's generally conversation and cleaning up.
Right. I always look forward to that part, the Shavasana part. But Chi, I mean, just for people who have done yoga, which I think is sort of more people have done yoga than have done Tai Chi Chuan, the concept of prana in yoga is probably pretty close anyway, right? That same notion of some kind of life energy that you're trying to tap into.
Yeah, I think that prana is associated primarily with breath, but it's larger than that. And chi is larger than breath as well. It is considered a universal life force, or the fuse that drives the green flower, as Dylan Thomas would say.
And in terms of that, are you simply cultivating and manipulating what's already inside you, or are you accessing chi that exists in an exterior space and trying to kind of ride that wave?
Both internal and external.
All right. So we're going to try to do this. I'm going to stand up. We're going to give him a microphone so that he can look at us while we're doing it. And so are you going to do it, Wolfie?
Oh, I was going to photograph
it. Oh, she's going to photograph it. So, Brittany, you're going to do it? All right.
Brittany's here.
All right. So is this me and Brittany, or is Betsy going?
No, Betsy's at the board.
Okay.
So for starters, I'd like you to spread your feet so they're hip width apart and soften your knees. And allow your spine to grow upwards like a blade of grass reaching towards the sun with your head floating at the top. In fact, you can separate the neck from the spine a little bit by working the head in a sort of figure eight so that you're growing upwards from the crown. And then if you'll sink down in your knees a little bit, we'll do three quick warm-up exercises. One is to just shake your hands. We're loosening things up and trying to get tension free and trying to open the meridians through which energy can flow in the body, those same meridians that an acupuncturist would try to open up through the use of needles. And then if you will, just twist your hips from side to side and let the arms flop. Don't shape the arms at all, but simply let the arms flop from side to side as you twist your hips. And then finally, as a warm-up, if you'll make some hip circles, but don't separate your spine from your pelvic bowl. Let the spine be included in the circle, so it's as if you're painting a circle in the air with a paintbrush hanging down from your tailbone, and that circle would be parallel to the floor. Now, we're going to go very quickly through what's called the five elements form as developed by Zhongliang Huang of the Living Tao Foundation. The five elements that we're going to be moving through are fire, water, wood, metal, and earth. So first, sink down. Bring your arms in and up as you inhale. And as you exhale, let the arms float down at the sides. And then imagine there's something palpable that you can grab in front of you and take a big scoop of it in as you step back and take that in towards your center and then press out with your palms and then let one arm float up and one arm float down as you mix yang and yin energy into your center or your dantian. And then once you have processed the yang and yin energy, you want to step forward. This is the fire element, as if you're sending the fire of you out into the world. It comes full circle back to you as the water element, raining down on you and nourishing you. And out of that water comes growth. So the third element is the wood element. You're going to walk around yourself in a circle. Your legs are like the trunk of a tree. Your arms are like the branches waving in the wind. And as you come back front, one arm will scoop back. This is the metal element, as if you're picking up coins from the bottom of the sea, from a sunken treasure chest, and you're dropping those coins into your Tai Chi piggy bank. This metal element gives way to the earth element, where you allow the arms to swing down and recoil upwards, touching base with the earth below and the sky above. The arms come down and then rise back up,
as if energy is coursing through you, that's being processed through your body but coming from the earth. And then this last gesture, Song Liang refers to as embrace tiger, your hands cross in front of your chest and then sink down and return to mountaintop. Embrace tiger, return to mountain is also the name of Song Liang's most seminal book on the teaching of Tai Chi. So that's the five elements form that you've just gone through.
That was fast. That was really good. All right, I'm going back to the microphone.
Okay. I think I want to try pickleball.
Yeah. Okay, thanks so much to Lydia Brown for being, what would you call that, sort of the audio engineer, the boom mic person, something like that. Thanks to Brittany Hill also for joining us in here and being my partner at Tai Chi Chuan. So, Tai Chi Chuan. So, you know, when I watched you doing it warming up, Robert Qualick, it seemed as though, and it often seems, I think, if we're watching the people in the park or wherever we encounter this, that as opposed to my kind of hopeless flailings, that when people – that really does look like they're sort of pushing something that you can't see or pulling something that you can't see. It really looks like there's an invisible set of bubbles and forces and stuff that people are working with. So tell me about that.
That's an excellent observation, and there does have to be some intentionality to the practice. So I ask students to slow their thinking down enough to gain a visceral awareness of their relationship between their skin and the air so that they begin to feel that there is something palpable and substantive around them that they can play with. And so that your image of a bubble is a very nice one. We do an exercise where it's as if we are holding a soap bubble and moving with it. The pushing and pulling is in a sense the martial application of taking this energy around you and forcing it away or pulling it in towards yourself. And so the muscles are not in use in the way that, say, a boxer would use muscles. There's not a lot of muscular force. But certainly the practice of the form has to include an intention about what is happening rather than it just be kind of a mushy dance.
You know, one of the things that happened in yoga – I did yoga pretty intensively for about 5 years. And as Americans kind of Americanized yoga, they Americanized yoga. And so that meant it got more – almost a little bit more competitive. And you started hearing terms like power yoga, you know, power vinyasa flow, this sort of idea that whatever this was, it was going to really be a workout form too that was sort of recognizably sort of sweaty and full of exertion. And after a while, you got this sort of backlash of people saying, well, that really isn't really what yoga is. And you guys are just – it's just aerobics or something and you guys call it vinyasa. It's this one seems a little less amenable to that, a little more this discipline seems more rooted in what it is and less likely to be turned into sweating to the oldies or something like that.
Well, so two things come up in what you say. One is that idea of co-opting a practice and making it into something that is an exercise form for people. And that certainly has happened and will continue to happen, especially given that there are multiple styles of Tai Chi. Yang style is the style we see most in the West that looks like that very flowing slow motion movement. But other styles like the Chen style are much more percussive and practice much more quickly. In fact, there are Yang style forms that are practiced quickly with weapons. I would say the style that I practice most in the keeping with the teaching of Song Liang has been westernized to some degree. So if you were to go to, say, the Yin Yang Tai Chi Chuan Academy in West Hartford, you would probably get a very traditional Tai Chi Chuan training experience. I teach in a way, and I have to pay tribute to Song Liang because he developed this way of teaching, that is much more amenable and accessible to a Westerner. So I do think you will see some changes to Tai Chi, especially as it catches on and folks adding their own voice to it as they teach.
All right, just continuing with my exploration of the yoga parallel. Another aspect to yoga is that, you know, I mean, almost inevitably, particularly if you're working with a teacher who's really been teaching for a long time, you're speaking some Sanskrit words and ultimately invoking some concepts that come out of Hinduism and that, you know, I mean, you can decide to make it more spiritual or less spiritual, but it is inherently spiritual. There are spiritual elements to it. There are elements that certainly arise from very old traditions. And my guess is with Tai Chi Chuan also, you're doing a set of physical activities, but inevitably also you're absorbing a philosophy at minimum, right? So can you elaborate on that a little bit? I mean, where else, besides just moving our body parts around, where else are we going?
So I think one could practice Tai Chi just from a physical perspective. But as one goes deeper, one is inevitably going to be reading literature from Chinese culture, Taoist literature specifically, the Tao Te Ching being the primary book. There is a connection to the physical environment and to nature specifically that a Tai Chi practitioner is going to have to incorporate into their work. In fact, the best place and time to practice is early in the morning outside where the air and the clouds and the birds are all readily accessible as points of reference and reflection for the practitioner. I would say that for me, the practice of yoga and the practice of Tai Chi are both movement-based spiritual disciplines. And so through the physicalization of this concept of yin and yang and their opposite polarities, one begins to enter into taking a look at the world in a different way. And one will want to enhance that new perspective through reading some Chinese literature. Now, there is a perception that Taoists practice Tai Chi and Tai Chi is a Taoist practice. There are certainly Taoists who practice Tai Chi. But I would say that the two of those things that we have distilled here in the West, because they are gems from the East, are not necessarily as connected as we might think.
Although I would imagine, and this is a struggle for me when I'm doing yoga, and the one time I did Tai Chi, which I did outside in the morning in a, in a grove, is the whole monkey mind problem, right? Somehow or other, I'm a typical Westerner. I'm thinking about 9 million things. And this kind of practice, I'm sensing, works a lot better and is more fully done. We only have about a minute left, so make your answer short.
Okay.
When you concentrate, right? Turn off the monkey mind?
So to turn off the monkey mind, you have to focus on the breath. But you probably need to know a form, and the form I taught is a very short one and fairly accessible if you have any muscle memory. Once you know the form and you can focus on your breathing and stay in the moment or be here now, you quiet the mind and your focus becomes on your body moving in space.
All right. Robert Qualick, thank you so much for joining us. Robert Qualick of Litchfield. He teaches a weekly class at Shareem Yoga and Fitness Studio in Litchfield. He could be your Tai Chi master, or if you live somewhere else, find somebody else. Thank you so much for joining us today to help us understand this.
My pleasure, Colin. Thank you.
All right. We've got Saul Neelman coming up. Very different kinds of sports after this.
I got thrown out of a Tai Chi tournament for using radiant energy-enhancing supplements. Actually, it might have just been speed. Today's show was produced by Betsy Kaplan and me. Our interns are Allison Ehrenreich, Brittany Hill, and Devin Flabbergaster. Greg Hill tweets for us at WNPR Colin and introducing Haig Papazian as the crazy doctor in the intro. For show pages, articles, and videos of the Faith Middleton Show staff playing competitive napkin folding, visit our website, WNPR.org. On tomorrow's show, the world of nonverbal communication. And now, back to Colin.
Well, you know, we've talked about some of the tamer new sports there are out there. We've talked about pickleball. We've talked about Tai Chi. But there's a frontier where people risk their lives, their reputations, their sanity to play sports that you've never heard of. And the person who is absolutely everything that Marlon Perkins ever was to wildlife, Saul Neelman is to weird sports. He is the chronicler and curator of them. He's the author of Weird Sports and the upcoming, unpredictably titled Weird Sports 2. These are photo books. They're published by a fine art publisher, Kara Verlag. He's with us, and so is Brandy Reddick. Brandy Reddick is a competitor in one of those weird sports, and that is extreme pencil fighting. And so, Brandy, I think maybe we're going to start with you, and for people who can't even paint a mental picture in their own minds about this, explain what extreme pencil fighting is all about.
the sport of world extreme pencil fighting takes the schoolyard sport of pencil fighting and brings it into a stage show combined with pro wrestling. It is America's fastest growing death sport.
This is when one person holds the pencil with one end in each hand, gripping in each hand, so it's held horizontally, while the other person strikes down with another pencil.
That's right. The World Extreme Pencil Fighting has some specific rules. So we have a defender and a striker, and our defender grips his or her pencil with two hands parallel to the ground, like you said, but they have to leave a space of not less than four pencil widths between their hands, so it's approximately an inch of striking area. And if they crowd in on the striking area, they can get a penalty. We also have some other penalty strikes that happen, too. But the striker holds his or her hand, typically like in a flicking motion, downward onto the striking area of the defender in an attempt to break the defender's pencil. But if they hit knuckles or if they whiff, again, that's a potential penalty. And for us, when you get a penalty called on you, you get up to five. When you get five penalties, you then get to strike against your defender using your homemade penalty pencil. And my particular penalty pencil goes with my character. She is from the Far East, and she has a very skilled set of martial arts. Her pencil is two gigantic 15-inch novelty pencils that she drilled out and attached to each other via 4-inch chain to make her signature pencil chucks. So she strikes not like the Karate Kid to break her defender's pencil on a penalty strike.
You know, with each breath that you take and each set of words that you say, this sport sounds less and less innocent. Initially, it sounded like a lovely extension of childhood now, of course. And so, Saul Neelman, after what you've seen, the knuckle strikes that you've witnessed, the blood that probably you've seen spilled, would you ever subject yourself to the rigors of world extreme pencil fighting?
No, I think I'm a little too smart for that. And I'm not quite the professional athlete that Brandi Redig is. She's not just known for extreme pencil fighting, but she's also a reigning roller derby queen. And in Seattle, she's an icon. She's part of the weird sports culture in Seattle.
You know, Brandi, I did watch some fairly grainy footage of world extreme pencil fighting, and it does seem as though there is some of the posturing that goes along with world wrestling entertainment, right? I mean, there's a lot of the trash talk and strutting.
There absolutely is. We do tag team wrestling. We do the lottery of the lead, where no one knows who will be facing who. It's a random drawing. And we also do my favorite, which is a cage match, where competitors compete pencil fighting in an oversized bird cage. They put their hands in there and flip back and forth.
Oh, my God. What are the worst injuries that you've sustained? I mean, have you been hurt by people either hitting you with pencils or those other alarming things that you were describing about sort of...
The worst shattering I ever had was the shattering of my ego when the San Juan Islands stole my championship belt from me. But other than that, it would have to be bloody knuckles, bruised hands, and probably a little bit of spittle from the trash talking.
What makes a great pencil fighter? In other words, is there a technique for bringing the pencil down so that the other person's pencils, I mean, are people measurably really a lot better than other people at this?
There is absolutely a difference in technique, and there are fighters who are better than others. People really develop their own techniques. Beginning people tend to break their own pencils on the strike. They go at it with way too much force. I personally choose to defend rather than strike, and I strike light, and I draw in very close to my chest, which makes male competitors a little hesitant sometimes because if they hit me, I might get that penalty strike on them.
Watching the grainy video that I've seen, it also seems as though there are some people who are just too timid, right? I mean, you can't have fear. You have to be willing to go for it.
I don't understand what that word fear means. Could you explain that to me?
Well, there are some people, who actually hesitate about doing certain things because they foresee possible harm to themselves or to other people. Does that make any sense to you?
No, I don't even understand that. It's fear is not in my vocabulary.
Right. But have you ever seen other fighters who seem to be unwilling, really, to strike with full force or to do what needs to be done? Maybe because even I know this is going to be a very hard concept for you to wrap your mind around, because they're actually afraid of hurting the other person.
they're afraid of being hurt themselves. Mm-hmm. You will not hurt a pro graphiter.
Now,
they're trained for this.
I wanted to also quickly ask you, before we get to Saul and some of the other sports that he's chronicling, and without getting us in too much trouble, there are people, all of you who compete, you compete under certain colorful names. I mean, there's a world champion or perhaps former world champion whose initials are the same initials as Happy Birthday. I don't think we're going to mention that particular person on this broadcast. But, I mean, there are people, either both the teams and the individual competitors have colorful names. Can you give us a few of those?
Absolutely. We have, from Tehran, Iran, we have the Graphite Sheik. We have the Penultimate Warrior. We have Betsy Threatsy, and we even have from another world a Ticonder robot, who is an actual robot. My favorite is the $100 Man.
Yeah, that would be my favorite, too. Now, where does this go on? Does it only go on in certain parts of the country? I'm sensing a Pacific Northwest flavor to all this, but is it more national than that?
Our graphiters train worldwide to be a part of the World Extreme Pencil Fighting League, but we typically hold our events in Seattle. That doesn't mean we're not averse to traveling. Any invitations, we will meet you.
You heard it here, listeners to this show. There's no reason not to start this up here, and they are willing to fly out here and teach you what true pencil fighting really means. I could see this becoming very, very big in Connecticut. So, Saul, I have to ask you a little bit more about weird sports in general, too. And maybe we can come back to Brandy and talk a little bit about roller derby as we wrap things up. We've had other roller derby people on, but it's interesting how big that's getting.
You haven't had anyone like her on. I tell you that right now.
I've already actually divined that. we should talk about some of these other sports. Some of them appear to fall into the category of sports that no sober person has ever played. I mean, flaming tetherball, which you've chronicled, and there are videos. I mean, it really seems as though to play this game and not have had a lot to drink would be just almost unthinkable. But explain about flaming tetherball. Not that it's a really complicated concept, but for those people who just can't imagine what flaming tetherball would be, what is that?
Well, it started by a guy named Rusty Oliver in Seattle. And instead of a tetherball, they use a roll of toilet paper, and it's soaked in 3 ounces of cooking gas, white gas. It's lit on fire. Of course, it's attached to a chain, and people play it with tennis rackets.
It's not remotely dangerous. I'd just like to...
You know what? Honestly, it's not. The embers, when they land, don't really do anything. You're not going to have a Michael Jackson scenario for some of your older listeners. But it's very surreal because when you start playing, the ball, as it were, is heavier and more predictable. Whereas as it burns off, it starts turning into a knuckleball. And if you can imagine trying to hit a knuckleball, okay, that's tough.
Mm-hmm.
But then it's on fire.
Right.
But, you know, when you're busy drinking cheap beer, that's the least of your problems.
Yeah, as I say, it's almost unthinkable that any sober person has ever played this game.
It's bad for training. It's not the way to go.
Right. And I think this is one of those situations where we can say, in full sincerity, kids, don't try this at home or anywhere else. Don't try it anywhere, actually. Wait until you're at least, until you've had a life and experienced most
of
the...
At least legal drinking age.
Yeah, and when you've experienced most of the things that count as life so that you don't mind if it ends abruptly. But now, you told me that your favorite among the sports that you chronicled, we're talking to Saul Neelman right now, and he does the weird sports books and the weird sports feature sometimes in Wired.com. You said that a live monster, I can't even say it, live monster wrestling is your favorite sport. So tell us about live monster wrestling.
Live monster wrestling, which was one of the first weird sports that I photographed. Well, it's called Kaiju. It's based in Boston, and it's a performance art. And there's characters like Chicken Noodle Soup. I'm distracted by the names because the only one that Brandy and I care about really is French Toast.
Okay.
I do like Gusto Bunny.
Oh, Dusto Bunny.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I'm actually Facebook friends with Dusto Bunny. So they build papier-mâché buildings within a boxing ring, wrestling ring, and they smash each other to bits with it. And they're battling good and evil, and somehow the balance of the universe is tied to who wins or loses. But I really think with all weird sports, we all win. I don't think
right.
There's a single loser out there.
either we all win or we all lose.
Pretty much.
The good thing is that all the fate of all humanity is tied together one way or the other, for good or bad. You know, there's so many things that we could conceivably cover here, but there are, some of these sports seem to have been made up yesterday, and then, you know, by people whose judgment was deeply impaired at the time. And then some of these sports have been around for a while. I mean, one of the things that you've chronicled is wife carrying. Now, wife carrying is at least 20 years old, right? I mean, this is, and it is a truly international competition. I mean, there are wife carrying teams that you know will congregate in Finland.
Oh, the Finns take it very seriously. Right. There's a Finnish couple, and I've seen them, and they're kind of jerks. They when they run on the course, they take no prisoners.
Right. I've seen videos of these people too, and it almost isn't fair. It's like watching Michael Jordan play a bunch of seventh graders in basketball.
Hoop. It's the equivalent of Jordan playing Nerf hoop.
Yeah.
I mean, it's.
But we need to sort of set the stage here, Saul. So in wife carrying, and I don't know how much variation there is, but what I've seen, the husband has the wife in an inverted position on his back, with her legs usually kind of wrapped around his neck. If you can sort of imagine that, so her head is kind of down where his butt is, and then her legs are wrapped around his neck, and she's usually wearing like a bicycle helmet or some kind of protective headgear. Yeah.
If she's smart, yeah.
And then take it from there. It's kind of a steeplechase from there, right?
That's pretty much it. I photographed one in Wales. I photographed one in Maine. I haven't been to the one in Finland yet. I've seen couples that were on a honeymoon. I've seen couples that were engaged. Mm-hmm. I've seen buddies or friends that just do it as a whim. But marriage separation has a completely different meaning during wife carrying, because you don't really want to drop your wife.
Right. And so what happens is, in the one that I saw anyway, they kind of burst off the starting line and run towards this water hazard. And,
right.
and the first thing they have to do is leap into this water hazard with the wife in this kind of locked position on the husband's back. And part of the landing, you have to make sure you don't decouple, as you're saying.
Right. You know, people are trying really hard. So wife carrying, and I'm not sure about the one in Finland, but the one in Maine, definitely the victor gets his wife's weight in beer. So you're kind of weighing, so to speak, whether or not, you know, it would be nice to have a lighter wife so that you could run the course faster, yes. But if you can carry a heavier woman, a heavier wife, you get more beer.
I hadn't really thought it out that way. That's interesting, because I initially watching it, I thought, well, whoever has the lightest weight wife is going to win. But now I understand.
Oh, no, you're motivated to have a hefty wife.
Right, yeah. Exactly. Other metrics that I hadn't really sort of counted on. All right, so I thought the funniest thing to watch, I haven't watched everything that you've chronicled.
Oh, you don't have that kind of time in your life.
Well, yeah, I do, but I need to spread it out. let me just put it this way. I don't want to binge watch weird sports, all right? I don't think that's good. Watching ostrich racing, and when we say ostrich racing, you might think, oh, they get a bunch of ostriches together and they have them race. No, this is like the Kentucky Derby, right? There's people trying to sit on the backs of the ostriches.
It reminds me of the Belmont. They line up into the gates, and then they open up the gates, and then the ostriches kind of go wherever they feel like.
Right. And it differs from horse racing in the sense that a much, much, much lower percentage of steed and jockey finish together, right? As you watch the ostrich race, the jockeys are strewn along the course.
It's closer to bull riding than it is to horse racing.
Right.
By far.
And one of the other hazards I can just tell you from watching is that after you fall off your ostrich, one of the trailing ostriches may step on you.
Right. It's like with NASCAR, people want to see a wreck. And as long as people are fine, that's great. Ostrich racing, people want to see a wreck.
Right. And so I'm going to ask you about one more thing. I mean, and we should say, first of all, that all of these things are watchable or viewable and digestible through the work of Saul Neelman. He's the author of Weird Sports and the upcoming Weird Sports 2. You're in Germany right now overseeing the publishing of Weird Sports 2. Am I correct?
That's absolutely correct. In fact, my designer, Katerina, has allowed me to use her landline here. She's working late. We're doing the final touches, going to press on Thursday.
There's a lot of bad things that can happen to you on a ski slope if you're just even trying to ski, right? Just trying to ski all by itself.
Especially when I'm trying to ski.
Right. It's a somewhat risky sport as it is. That doesn't seem to be enough for some people, and there are a number of things that people you've discovered have tried to do. And I did get to see a little bit of the downhill barstool skiing, a sport whose very name contains, I think, that same element that we talked about before. But explain.
Drinking.
Yeah.
It involves drinking. In fact, like a lot of events, it was started at a bar. Legend has it, the ski slopes in Montana, that this guy was hesitant to leave the bar. Mm. And some young skiers said, hey, why don't you go skiing? And he goes, you know what? I'll go skiing when you put skis on my bar stool. And that's how it started.
Right.
And it's, I forget, I almost say it's been going on for 30 years perhaps. And it's even been modified. They do modified bar stools. I saw an entire platform with a table and four chairs. I've seen rock bands slide down. They're playing the entire time. Mm. So it's pretty remarkable. But for better or worse, it's really tucked away off the beaten path. And, you know, one of the things that I love is traveling around. I get to know the world better. But I also go to places I would never go to. And a very small town in Montana, they host one of the best things in America, and very few people know about it.
First of all, the thrill of victory, the agony of defeat, Weird Sports and the upcoming Weird Sports 2. How soon will Weird Sports 2 be out, and how easy will it be for the average person who doesn't know the secret password to obtain?
Well, if someone slips me some money, I might get them an advanced copy, but it'll be released in the States next spring.
All right.
And it'll be out in Europe this fall.
So, Brandy Reddick, you're still with us, and you know, we talked to you about world extreme pencil fighting, but that's not the only sport that you're involved in. And we know from around here in Connecticut, boring old Connecticut, we've had something of a roller derby renaissance. And the people doing roller derby, I think, you know, are maybe a different crowd than the group that was doing roller derby in the 50s and 60s. So what can you tell us about your experience? First of all, who are you skating for, and what's it like these days?
Switching gears quite a bit from pencil fighting and going into roller derby, they are quite different, as you can imagine. The resurgence of roller derby started in the U.S. around 2003 in Texas, and it spread slowly at first with four other leagues around the nation. New York, Arizona, and Seattle was one, with the Rat City Roller Girls, and I was one of the founding members of the Rat City Roller Girls. When we first started, we were absolutely a weird sport, very unique. Many of the women who joined were young enough to either not even have seen roller derby or heard of it before. We didn't know how to play the game, didn't know the rules, what it was supposed to look like, so we made it up. Mm. And a lot of us, speaking for myself, who does have a very big, some might call it unhealthy interest in American professional wrestling, started to develop characters for the sport. And so when I skate roller derby, I do skate as Reddick to Rumble, and half of my face is painted like a skull. So I am very much akin to a wrestling heel as I skate, and very much a villain on the track. But when we first started roller derby, the resurgence, it was a lot more theatrical. But over the last 10 to 12 years that it's been coming back, roller derby has really evolved into a real and legitimate sport, and there's actually a push to try to get into the Olympics. There are leagues all over the world now. This has had an incredible resurgence, especially for women, but also men are getting involved. There are co-ed teams and all-men teams as well. So this is a case where something that started out as one of Saul's very weird, obscure sports has turned into something, at least striving to be, quite legitimate.
Somehow or other, the idea of Vladimir Putin trying to develop, you know, a top-flight Russian roller derby team scares me. You know, the idea of, you know, some kind of secluded compound out on the Russian steppes somewhere.
Is there drug testing for roller derby?
Yeah, well, I've retired from roller derby, but if Russia gets the team together and challenges the U.S., I'll tell you what, I'm putting that paint back on.
Oh, I see. Yeah, I see the film right now. You know, and they approach you, and you're there painting with, you know, watercolors on your easel, and you say, "I don't do that anymore." And they say, "No, you've got to do it one last time for USA. USA.
USA.
All right.
That's great.
We couldn't end on a more fabulous note. Saul Neelman, so great to talk to you. Brandy Reddick, great to make your acquaintance. Thank you so much for sharing weird sports, roller derby, extreme pencil fighting, and all the other stuff with us today.
Thank you very much for having
us. Thank you so much.
All right. Bye-bye now.
Bye-bye.
All right. Take care, Brandy.
Bye, Saul.
Well, that was great. But then we thought, you know, Saul Neelman, he needs some kind of sports theme music for his weird sports. So we called up the sports theme music guy we know, John Tesh. And I said, "John, I know you're busy. I know your schedule is packed. I know you barely have time to sleep. But is there any way you could write something, some kind of sports theme for Saul Neelman?"
My theme was written over an answering machine, you know, back in the day when there were answering machines. And I sang the thing. I got an idea in the middle of the night.
Mm-hmm.
and didn't have any recording materials or machines with me or even any manuscript paper, and I just sang,
I'm Kyone Wolfe, and when I won the backward running egg balancing fish toss world championship, I had one mantra running through my head. Tesh, Tesh, Tesh. Isn't that right, John Tesh?
As you're running, it's the thing that just sort of repeats forever in your head.
Yeah, John. That's why it's called a mantra. Come on, John Tesh.